negative emotion, suffering, resisting negative emotion. And I think this is something that probably any human, every human can relate to past the age of, well, I mean, even as toddlers, we did this, right? You know, we didn't want something to be a certain way. And so we threw toddler fits about it when we were little. And then we grew up not knowing how to, like, being conditioned, bred to avoid our emotions. We've been conditioned to eat it away, have a dessert, have ice cream, have cake, have a cookie, honey. Let's go shopping, retail therapy. Change whatever you're doing. Do something else. Don't think about it. Don't spend your time on that. Think about something else, like diversion, avoid, go around, ignore, pretend like it's not happening. All of those ideas or like approaches to it, not really approaches to anything except for getting away from it. And when we do that, we end up only prolonging our trip. Whatever that little thing is that was put in front of us, we were clearly supposed to go through and not around or over or under. As soon as I said that, this is such an obscure line. Do you guys remember? If you don't know already, I think I live in my head in like, what was that first? It's like one of the first cable shows, Dream On, maybe. Like, I always have movie lines running through my head, quotes from movies. And just now I just thought of Chicken Run. We tried to go under the fence. That didn't work. Anyway, very, like I said, obscure. Probably nobody knows it. But we try to go all these different ways around the negative emotion or the suffering that every human does go through. Not every human goes through alienation, clearly, right? But we all have our own little things that our door's backpack, right? That analogy that I like to think are sort of predetermined in our life. You don't have to take that on as yours. If that offends you, I get it. But we each have our own little path that we walk. And so if we don't go through and try to detour it, we end up creating this really long, long detour path. And a lot of times the detour path in the avoiding, like the things we do in order to avoid, cause us so many more like tolls to pay, right? The cost at the end is so much more. I could write a book on that alone, seriously, on just like how much suffering I self-inflicted suffering that I lived through because I was terrified of whatever was ahead of me. And it wasn't like any one specific thing. It was just whatever I was dreading, I would do anything in my power to pretend like it wasn't there, avoid, not go, numb, just get it away from me. Because, you know, it's always in our minds always make it like it's so vague in our minds, like that dun, 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 you know, what's going to happen? You hear like thunder and lightning and like, oh, it's going to happen whenever you get to that thing, whatever you're dreading. But our minds never actually tell us what might happen. Well, I can't say never. There are times where we paint all the scenarios and then we go into like the catastrophizing and what if this, what if that, blah, blah, blah. And they're always usually way worse than what actually ends up happening. Or, well, I could talk about this for days. Or the other option is that we make the very worst possible thing happen because we avoid and we don't show up. But either way, the avoiding, the resisting, the numbing away from or denying whatever it is that we're telling ourselves is worthy of dreading is unproductive at the very best and usually really causes, for me anyway, it caused a lot of damage. It caused a lot of heartache and a lot of extra time. And so it took me a really long time. Nobody else could tell me. Like, I couldn't have learned this lesson through the wisdom of anybody else. Like, I had to learn it for myself. And I was really hard-headed about that. I don't know if any of you guys can relate to this. But feeling like, and I talk about this a lot, I think, in the podcast. I think I do. About how hard-headed I really, really was for so many years, and probably still am. I'm not going to. But I feel like I need to let it, the circumstances get to like really bad. I need the messages to be like blaring in my ear before I'm like, oh, so I'm not really supposed to do that, huh? So maybe you guys can relate to that. But yeah, only to find out, this was my point, sorry. What I was avoiding isn't really that bad. And even if it is unpleasant, which a lot of times the things that we're avoiding are, even if it really is or would be very unpleasant to come to terms with, it's going to have to happen at some point. I can't just ignore it for the rest of my life, depending on what we're talking about here. But if we're, let's bring it to like, you know, alienation. I used to avoid, and I did this like even in school, way before alienation happened, but I used to avoid having to write the email, respond to the email, look at the email even from my ex. You know, I couldn't stand, and I know a lot of you guys can relate to this one, but I could not stand knowing that there was an email in my inbox from him, or really probably the stepmom, right? Because that email was always this berating, threatening, accusing, criticizing, micromanaging, like, shit show of an email. And usually it was like a Bible, you know, like a fucking like roll the scroll out, all of this stuff, parading and all of the things that they do, right? It used to send me straight into a full on. I mean, it did it before I even opened the email. Just knowing that the email was sitting in my the inbox, I would already be in a low grade trauma response before it even happened, thinking about what it could be. Right? What might be the issue this time? How it might affect me? When am I going to be picking my daughter up? Is he trying to take my daughter this time? All of these, the scenario plays going on in my head. And so there were times where, especially if I knew that there wasn't information that I needed to get right away, like it had to do with an exchange coming up like that day or something, there were times where I wouldn't open a certain email for, depends on what we're talking about. After she went over to her dad's, there were times where I wouldn't open the email for months because I couldn't bear it. I couldn't bear coming to terms with and reading whatever I knew he was going to write anyway. The emotional part of the brain makes it out to be like this huge deal that we must avoid at any cost. Hold on. So that... Yeah, my brain made it out to be like, so that I must avoid it at all costs. But I knew what was going to be in the email, mostly. What was such a big deal about it? What is it that I was so scared of? And same for you, you know? What was the alienator going to say that was going to like rock my world so much? What it was going to be was maybe an emotion. But what I was making the emotion and the discomfort mean is an entirely different situation. And that is the part that caused me the most suffering. Not actually, although it was abusive and wrong and whatever, we can have a laundry list of things that is not desirable about whatever the alienating parent party is writing. That's on them. But what I was making my emotion mean, my trauma response mean, was really causing the most suffering. Because I was making the whole situation so dun-dun-dun that I couldn't function, as opposed to deciding to be like, okay, so he's just being him. I used to call him Satan. I stopped that because it really only created a icky feeling inside of me. So I stopped calling him pet names, you know, and just kept it very neutral. He was my neutral circumstance. I've been talking about that pretty frequently in the episodes lately, you know, just making the what you are labeling as so negative, create that in your mind, a space of neutrality. For me, the person who's alienating my kid from me, he's just a neutral. This is just who he is. Just as, you know, there's people that do bad things out there, but because it's not yet personal to me, those people, I can do the same thing with him. You know, the person who's alienating my kids from me. My kid. One kid. So I just kind of got off on a little thingy. So I was making it super stressful, right? As opposed to being like, he is who he is. We know, me and the party in my head, we know he's going to show up this way. We know he is. Him, his wife, they are going to do what they do. They're going to belittle. They're going to do all the things that they do. And instead of me trying to judge it or put myself higher than them or lower than them and feel like that I have to answer to them, I just allow that smoke show is basically what they're doing to be just that. And then I just look through, like if I was to be looking at an email now, I would just sift through, find the facts of whatever they were trying to convey. And if there was anything that I needed to respond to, right? I'm sure you guys all know this part of it. Then you pick out what you need to respond to and act on. You know, if there's a change in drop-off pickup times or whatever it may be, maybe you guys have to, whatever, answer that. And then I just let the other stuff go. But back in the day, I used to avoid these kinds of emails because I didn't want to be faced with the idea of the negativity. I knew the second that I read the words, I told myself that those words were much more powerful than they were. I made it seem like those words were like, I made it personal, you know? And although it affects me personally, his words don't have to be personal. It's just his viewpoint, his wife's viewpoint. And I can see how they got that viewpoint. I don't need to go into judgment about it, but I can see where on their side of things, they may think very well, guaranteed, they think that they are justified and right, even in their lies. But usually we all do to some extent, but especially these kinds of people believe everything they're saying, even if it's fabricated. They truly stand by it and believe it. Basically, what I'm saying is that usually the things that we're fearing or trying to avoid are not as bad as our brain likes to make them out to be. And if we just pull away all of the drama that we add to it, then we have ourselves a pretty bland story of, like, if you were to be writing, I hate this analogy, but it is true. Like a police report. I hate the analogy because then that gives the idea that things are maybe more dramatic than they are. But I mean, in a police report, you see things written out very man said blah, blah, blah to woman. It's very impersonal. And that's what helped me to depersonalize it, pull it away from me, and get some perspective on all the situations, right? In trying to avoid the negative emotions, we end up usually creating like such a bigger mess for ourselves. You know, there's so much more cleanup in the end. And so don't do that. That's what I'm basically trying to say. Don't do that. But like I said, I had to learn it for myself and I had to like hit my own bottom with that. Too. But negative emotion is just like I was just saying in the episode, it's just an emotion. It's just a vibration in your body. It's almost always that it's the story that we have about it that is really causing us the pain. This shouldn't be, they shouldn't be acting this way. I should have my daughter or my son in some of your cases, you know, they shouldn't have said those false, you know, brought on false charges, accusations, all the things, right? We have this When I say this, please don't take this wrong, but I'm trying to think of a better word, but we have this entitlement, all of us as humans, I think, to this always good experience of the world. And I know I'm like right now wanting to argue with myself because I know that what I would have replied to me just saying that, like, yeah, but everything's been bad. When is it just going to get good? When can I please, like, nobody else has what I'm dealing with. I have it coming at me at all angles is where I would have gone with that. But I think too, it took me a really long time to understand that it was a lot of things, but it was also my perspective on what was coming at me or not and where I could take back my power so that I wasn't in the place where things could come at me, you know? So that once I started standing in my power and really having agency over myself and my life and my choices, right, then it wasn't so. So we have this entitlement as humans, I think, to not having bad experiences, to not feeling pain or suffering. And I just want to offer that, maybe question that if that's what's going on for you. Because without the bad, we wouldn't have the good. Without the sadness, we wouldn't have extreme happiness, glee, excitement, wonder, serendipity, all of those good, amazing emotions. Something has to counter those. And we wouldn't appreciate all the good. We wouldn't even know bad was bad if we didn't have all of the textures, the spectrum. I don't want to feel good about what's going on with my daughter, right? I don't. I'm never going to feel like, yay, my daughter alienated from me. And yay, who knows what's happening inside of her because of it? No. I want to be upset about that, right? I just don't want to add on extra suffering to that by droning on sitting in the problem. We can talk about the problem, looking for the solution, searching for the solution, and grow ourselves in order to cause the solution to come to fruition. Take all the steps and in the meantime, continue to grow ourselves. I just lost my train of thought because I just heard my dog on the door. Where was I? Oh, right. Choosing the emotions on purpose. And if you heard this last week's episode, I talked about my client that I've known for a while, and she 2 weeks in a row had this trust theme going on. She's got clearly has this old belief about not being able to trust anybody that's like really coming up for her over the last couple of weeks, right? And so of course this is going to keep showing up because whatever we think on the most is going to, we're going to find it in our lives. And so in this case, I mean, I'm not going to, you'll hear the episode, but basically, yeah, she had one incident with her mom from basically found out something different about a story she was told in her childhood. But it was really about what I didn't share is that whatever my client was being told as a child was because she was a child. And also it was really had nothing to do with my client. She's here. I almost said your name. She's in this group. So maybe you'll see it. It had more to do with my client's mom. And so it wasn't like, by the way, we found out that you are adopted or something, you know, that wouldn't make sense. Do you know what I'm saying? Her and her brother were questioning trust, right? Whether they could trust anybody and was their childhood a lie and what have you. And then she was thinking about this one. I know that so many of us share is that we think back about past relationships, especially the alienator, but any other, if you have a pattern of like me, of a type, and that type being maybe narcissist, or it was, you know, at one point, or narcissist traits, then you may have had this thought a lot, but like, was any of that even real? Was that whole relationship a sham? Was the marriage, all the time I invested in this, was this completely just all a lie? And the answer to that, this is what I didn't say in the episode, is no, it's not a lie. It's absolutely not a lie because, I mean, maybe it was on their side of things, like to themselves, right? But they showed up in a certain way. Let's say your ex was had lied throughout the whole thing. Thinking about it now, it's a complete sham. I can't believe I led my life as a lie. No, because you showed up and it wasn't a lie for you. All of those moments happened. In fact, you have proof of it because you've got children, right? That came out of it. You know that you lived that and it was true. Things happened, right? It's your perception of it after the fact that is what is your truth. But then your ex who was doing the lying or whatever they were doing, even while doing it, just like I was kind of touching on before, they probably believed those lies, but they were still showing up. It's not like the whole thing was like a mirage. No, it happened. So your whole life, the time that you invested wasn't a lie. And it never could be. That wouldn't be, it's not possible. You were there for those moments. It was real for you. You have evidence to show for it, right? Children, offspring, evidence, and other things. Probably a marriage license, all the things. It wasn't a lie. It wasn't a sham. You were there for it. And like I said, yeah, I'll leave that alone. So yeah, so she was questioning whether all that stuff was a lie and should I trust anybody anymore? So many of us, again, we take this stance where it's like, forget it. I'm never going to trust anybody again. People, you can't rely on anybody. People, you just can't trust them. People are only for themselves and yada, yada, yada. Taking that stance is only going to get you exactly what you're fearing will happen in the future if you stay with them or get vulnerable in the future. So relationships are to connect. Like that's what we do in relationships, right? If we get vulnerable, the higher the vulnerability, the more intimacy is possible, the more that you open up to that. It's transactional. We don't want to think about it like that, but it's good for you. You want to feel connected with somebody. So in order to connect with them, you need to give something of yourself. If you tell yourself that you don't want to risk getting hurt, so you're not going to do that anymore, then you're actually doing the job of hurting yourself, doing what you think they're going to do to you ahead of time, right? So you're basically just like, oh, nope, I'm not going to do that. So let's just never, ever connect with anybody and we'll stay back here. And then you're always alone. So you're punishing yourself beforehand. And then for all this time going forward, you miss out on connection and love, camaraderie, intimacy. And that's what we're made for. Humans, we're communal creatures. And so if you decide that because you've been hurt before, that you're not going to do it again, that it's just too hard, it's just too much, then you sort of pull away from your contract here on Earth. You know, like this is part of the deal. Negative emotions happen. That is, we can decide that we choose to have and feel those negative emotions because we know with the negative emotions, there is a much greater chance of us feeling the positive. That's the exchange. So I've chosen to like be here for all of the emotions. Like getting good at especially the negative ones, it's like it's literally your key to the universe. It is how you can conquer anything that's in front of you. Because everything that we avoid or don't allow ourselves to do or risk for ourselves is we don't do it because we think we're going to feel a negative emotion. If we just decide, all right, we're going to feel negative emotion, it's just a vibration, then you just go do the thing anyway. And guess what? You look back and you've been living life. You haven't locked yourself up in a cave. You know, oh, don't do that. It's going to hurt you. You never know. Don't get vulnerable. Don't let that person hurt you. Don't go for the job because they may reject you. You're just sitting there protecting yourself from life. And then what? Then all you have to look back on is the negative experience that you've already experienced. And you're telling yourself, nope, we're not going to do that again. Like go for success of anything or go for intimacy, go for whatever it is that you want to do. It doesn't have to be just with relationships. I mean, I guess everything's a relationship, but like intimate relationships or familial relationships, it could be like for a job, for whatever. If you cut yourself off from that, then you all you have to really think about and base your entire life off of is the alienation and all the trauma, the crap that's happened. And so then you're perpetuating that story for the rest of your life. And people wonder why they feel stuck after something is traumatic as alienation. This is why. Because we're not allowing ourselves to be vulnerable, to be hurt again. And then the only stories we have to tell ourselves are the ones from the past about how we were hurt. Okay.